The first way in which you captured the world's attention was at university. And that's what I want to talk about now, because the C-16 law in Canada was being proposed. And what I think many people that are cross-examining you and your views are confusing is what exactly you are opposed to.
Yeah, they think I'm opposed to transgender rights.
Yeah, and of course your stance on this, including the stance of Lindsay Shepherd,
yes,
sort of shot you to the public eye. And so, speak to us a bit about that, and exactly contextualize for us what it is precisely that you were opposed to in that.
Yeah, case. Well, Bill C-16 purported to do nothing but extend human rights provisions to an excluded group, let's say, to the transgender and non-gender binary types, and that was the federal legislation. It also made it a hate crime to discriminate or harass, essentially. So now then the question is, well, what exactly do you mean by discriminate or harass? And why exactly is that a hate crime under the criminal code? Well, there was an answer to that. The answer was, well, this bill will be interpreted in light of the policies generated by the Ontario Human Rights Commission, very large set of policies. Now, the Ontario Human Rights Commission is a radically leftist organization. I think it's the most dangerous organization in Canada, although you could debate that. And they set out all sorts of policies about how this legislation was going to be interpreted. And the federal government linked to their website to state that Bill C-16 would be interpreted in light of those guidelines. So I went and read all the policies. Well, one of the policies was that if you didn't use the preferred pronouns of a given group, that you could be charged essentially with a hate crime. And I thought, no,
group is that? You're talking about transgender people.
Yeah, so there's all these pronouns that have come up. There's 70 different sets of pronouns approximately to hypothetically describe people who don't fit anywhere on the gender spectrum, which is also something that I don't really understand. I don't understand that conceptually. Mm. Like,
yeah. We'll come to that. But yeah, I just want to hear the story of this bill first.
Okay, so now a person is compelled under Canadian law to use the pronoun of another individual's choice on pain of law. And I thought, well, no, that's not acceptable. It's one thing to put limits on what a person can't say, like say with hate speech laws, which I also don't agree with, by the way, but that's a different argument. I think it's a narrower argument. But to compel me to use a certain content when I'm formulating my thoughts or my actions under threat of legislative action, I thought, no, what's happened there is the government has introduced compelled speech legislation into the private sphere. It's never happened in the history of English common law. And so I said, there's no way I'm abiding by that. I don't care what your damn rationale is. We're compassionate. It's like, no, you're not. No, you're not. You're playing this radical collectivist left-wing game. You're trying to gain linguistic supremacy in the area of public discourse. You're doing that using compassion as a guise, and you're pulling the wool over people's eyes. And you're not going to do it with me.
Could that same rationale be used for, in the UK, Holocaust denial isn't illegal, yet the people that deny the Holocaust are seen as crackpots. Yet in Germany, it's illegal. The rationale that was used to put this law forward in Canada, do you see any form of similarity between those that would suggest, for example, in the name of compassion, that Holocaust denial should become a crime?
Yeah, well, it is a crime in Canada, actually. It has been since the 1980s. And I think that was a dreadful mistake. And it's not because
It's not here, by the way.
No, well, that's good. I'm glad to hear that. It's not like there's no such thing as hate speech. It's not like there's no such thing as reprehensible, hateful speech. Obviously, those things exist. That's not the issue. You're always balancing risk. So one risk is you let crackpots utter hateful dialogue, risk number one. Risk number two is you hand over to the state the definition of hate and the ability to police the speech of individuals. That's risk two. For me, risk two far outweighs risk one, partly because if you let the damn crackpots have their say, most reasonable people listen to them, assume they're crackpots, and that's the end of it.
This is a traditionally English liberal argument.
That's exactly on
option two there, you know, basically the state deciding what you can or cannot say and defining it as hate. Speak to me about Lindsay Shepherd and what happened to her.
Oh, well, you know, okay. So when I took my stance against Bill C-16, the first thing that happened was a variety of left-wing lawyers came out of the woodwork and said, you're exaggerating the danger. Now, luckily, the university immediately sent me two letters telling me I should stop saying what I was saying. See, I made the videos criticizing the bill, and I said when I made the videos that they were probably illegal, that it was probably an illegal act to make the videos criticizing the legislation.
It hadn't become law yet.
No, but it was law in provincial law still. It hadn't become federal law, so the legal framework was already there. So, you know, people said, well, you're exaggerating the danger. You won't be hauled off to jail, which, by the way, is not true, because if the Ontario Human Rights Commission finds you guilty of harassment and fine you or subject you to forced re-education, and you refuse to do it, it's tossed into the normal legal system. And then if you don't listen to the normal legal system, you're found guilty of contempt of court, and then you can be jailed. So it's perfectly, jail is a perfectly possible outcome. All right, so I said, well, I think this is probably illegal what I was doing. And the left-wing lawyer type said, oh, you're just exaggerating the danger. You know, you're a radical, you're exaggerating the danger. But the university had their lawyers review what I was doing. And they immediately concluded that I was probably breaking the law too. And under the provisions of the Ontario Human Rights Commission, the same dreadful organization, if you're an employer in Ontario, you are as legally responsible for the utterances of your employees, whether you know about the utterance or not, whether or not they made it when they were working for you or on their free time, and whether or not they intended any offense. So the university read that and thought, oh, well, we have to stop Peterson because we're on the hook for his utterances and what he's doing might be illegal. So they sent me two letters telling me to stop, which was horrible because my job was on the line, but which was good because I said, well, this is how the law is constituted. And that was immediate proof. And then a few months later, this graduate student, 22-year-old graduate student named Lindsay Shepherd at Wilfrid Laurier University, dared to show a 5-minute clip of a public television show where I was debating Bill C-16, a very mainstream public television show.
I'm pretty much saying what you're saying now here.
Exactly the same kind of discussion we're having now. And she was hauled in front of a Maoist inquisition consisting of two of her half-wit professors from the communications department, radical Marxists both, and an administrator from the University of Wilfrid Laurier University who was hired to persecute students in this particular situation.
What happened to Lindsay?
Oh, well, they told her that she was in violation of Canadian law, fundamentally. Absolutely. Absolutely. And she had the sense to record this. And, well, there was complicated reasons for that, but she made the recording public. And it was, well, it went viral. It was the biggest scandal that ever hit a Canadian university. Then,
did they say that it's like playing Hitler?
Oh, or Milo Yiannopoulos. That I'm either Hitler or Milo Yiannopoulos because these left-wing radical types can't even get their damn insults straight. It's like, really? I'm like Milo Yiannopoulos or Hitler? You know, what kind of thinking is that? And first of all, and to use the casual comparison to someone like Hitler, yeah. I think that's an appalling ethical crime. You use that accusation under very, very specific circumstances when something extraordinarily serious and dangerous has happened, because otherwise you risk diluting the currency of the comparison. And that's the last thing you should do if you care about such things.
Reduced to tears.
Yes, although she's a super tough person, man, and she bounced back like mad. Now, the Wilfrid Laurier they apologized to her formally. They set up a panel to reconstitute Wilfrid Laurier's policy on free speech. But last week, the only two professors on the panel who were pro-free speech resigned because the university had watered down its policies so much that it was pointless for them to consider. They didn't learn a damn thing, even though it was the biggest scandal that ever hit a Canadian university. So that's the, we,